I could not wait to do that.
Oh my God.
I couldn't wait to do it. How's it going, man?
Oh, it's going. Are we recording right now?
We're recording for sure.
Is that our intro?
That's our intro. you have no idea how much joy that's bringing me.
It's because I'm Mexican, though. I'm okay with it, though.
Oh, no. No, that's because my wife has been listening to Selena all day. So I have that song stuck in my head. So to tell our listeners, when I called you, I was singing that song.
The first words of conversation were, come on, La Flor, come on, La Flor.
Oh, keep going. What else did I do? Keep going.
Then you did bitty, 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 bum, bum.
Oh, Selena, R.I.P. R.I.P. Miss Selena. We're going to go. I think our closing music is going to be bitty, bitty, bum, bum. It's kind of hard not to do that, huh? Oh, God. Blake, how's it going, brother?
Man, it's going good, man. It's another, you know, Sunday fun day.
Yep.
But it's just relaxed. I'm just relaxing today, man.
Yeah,
take
man.
How you doing, man?
Well, what better way to relax than to talk about some Floyd Mayweather, Conor McGregor hype?
That's how I treat every day. I love it. It's just another day, you know, in the life.
So, yeah, man. You asked me before we started, kind of, what were we going to do today? And I never answered your question. And the reason why I didn't answer your question is because I don't know.
Yeah, okay. It's probably best you didn't tell me.
Listen, well, no, I'm telling you it's because I don't know. Mm-hmm. Everything keeps taking a bunch of turns while also not taking any turns at all. Like, hear me out on this. This whole thing involving, how do you pronounce Paul's last name?
Malignaggi,
because I don't want to mispronounce it. Pauly Malignaggi, okay? This whole thing involving him might be the least surprising thing I've seen in my entire life. So let me get your first reaction here. Is that what's happening right now, is it surprising to you?
After what I heard on down low about some stuff that happened after the first sparring session.
Well, I'm saying let's pretend like you don't even have any type of sources.
Okay.
I don't have any sources. Remove that from your brain. Is the fact that Conor McGregor released a picture that may or may not be misleading, right? I assume it's misleading, but no, I don't know. And even if you have a source, you don't actually know until you've seen some type of evidence for it. So he releases a picture that may or may not be misleading, but the fact the picture was released at all was a shitty thing to do. But I'm asking genuinely, is it surprising to you? Because to me, not in the slightest. There's nothing about it that's surprising.
So it depends which way you're coming at this. My opinion, since I know both worlds, no. It's not. But like, if you're just a boxing fan and you're interested in this fight, you're looking at this like, damn, that's fucked up, man. Like, hey, you know, the first time you see it, you're like, damn, okay. Second, third time, you're like, damn, dude, like, he's really doing him like that. But then if you're a Conor fan, or if you understand Conor's, let's say not even a Conor fan, but if you understand Conor's entertainment and marketing and just social media, it's not surprising at all, you know. If he can get one up, if he can make himself look good, why not? It sells. People love it. People are going to click. So it just depends on what mindset you're coming from. Me knowing both worlds, you know, it's kind of not surprising. Like, I'm not acting surprised. Like, oh, my God, I'm surprised. I'm not surprised. But, it's not, you know, it's also not cool to do, but not surprised.
Yeah, like I said, I mean, I don't think that it's something that he should or should not have done, although – let's just have this conversation. I wasn't planning on like necessarily having this conversation, but let's just do it. I don't give a shit. It's because I am so skeptical. I'm so skeptical right now. This fight is going to generate and has already generated, right? But will certainly generate an absurd amount of money. I think we could be pushing 7 million buys here. I think we might surpass that. I mean, I think this is going to be unreal. And what Paulie's doing right now, he could not be selling this fight more if he was trying to, which makes me feel like he is trying to. Like, the amount of money that is being tossed around, we're talking about corruptive levels of money here. And I don't know if someone like Polly is immune to that. Now, this is just a baseless theory. I'm just talking out my ass here, you know. So everyone save whatever bullshit you're going to say to me. Like, say, not you. You can say whatever you want to me. I'm talking about the people who are listening to this to be like, well, this dumbass. Just save it. I'm just shooting off the cuff here because it's interesting. But I like, this may very well be a tactic. A tactic to A, I'm just going to go, I'll go all the way with it. He could be a Conor McGregor shill, right? Which I said in the group as a joke, but the more that he kept going with it, the more I'm like, why is he doing this? Like, he's selling the fight. I am so much more interested in watching Conor McGregor after this whole Polly nonsense than I was before. And for no reason, other than on one hand, if I'm able to separate that I think it's fake, if I can pretend like it's all real, it makes me want to see Conor be able to do something as a extreme underdog and to disprove a lot of these guys who are all coming at him. Especially when you see Polly doing like a breakdown, like, well, if you look right here, Conor turns into the choke and does this. Get out of here. If you're not going to let Conor, you know, talk about boxing, right? All the boxing fans who talk about how Conor doesn't know shit about boxing and MMA fans don't know shit about boxing, so they should keep their mouth shut. Polly should keep his mouth shut about stuff pertaining to MMA because he has no idea what he's talking about. He hasn't lived it. He hasn't experienced it. If he stepped into an octagon, a low-level fighter would rip the limbs off of his body. So, relax. The lowest of the low would render him unconscious with a choke. So, you know, he probably should keep his mouth shut on that front as well. But I'm just kind of ranting here. Where are you at? Do you really think this is all 100% real? To me, it feels like it's world. It's WWE. That's what it feels like to me.
I think it's. Oh no! I need to get my charger.
You're fine.
I need to charge your phone. I got to turn.
Go ahead.
Yeah, because I'm using like video.
Go ahead.
Oh, okay. No, I was gonna just, let me talk a little bit, and then I'll while you're talking on next time, I'll go grab it.
Okay, go ahead.
But yeah, I mean, my thing is it's inadvertent. I think it's inadvertent attention that he's making drawn to this. Like, I don't think it's his intention to like make this more of a spectacle. Like, I think his intention is his ego feels bruised.
Okay,
and he's out, like, he's Italian for one. Okay, he's Italian. He's a boxer. He's feeling slighted by Conor for doing the things that are not done in a boxing world, right? Like, that's not something you fucking do in this world. So there's a certain level of disrespect, and I think of having to clear his name in front of all these other fans that he's not used to interacting with, because all the fans see the pictures and then they want to, oh shit, he got him. And I think there's a large level of Paulie that's feeling like, whoa, 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 like, no, 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 no. Let me clear this up in the best way that I can, without giving all of Conor's game plan away or all of what happened away. Like, so that's why he's saying broad things like, guys, just check the video. Guys, this is what, like, this is, you know, even that one interaction me and you had where, you know, somebody was like, well, you know what you're getting into, you know, what if he takes photos? He's like, I mean, that's cool. I don't think he thought it was going to be like this, though. Like, it's cool to be cool with something.
I just, like how couldn't he have? To say that he didn't know that Conor would try to pull some shit like this would be to imply that he's a moron. Honestly, it would be to imply that he's a moron, because how would he not know?
Or he's not familiar enough with Conor, which I certainly think is really the real driving force behind something like that. Like, you're not aware of what Conor can do. Like, there's always the potential, right? There's always a potential for everything. There's a potential for this or that. The potential is always there. I'm sure it crosses mind. I'm sure he's gonna be like, no, he's not gonna do that though. Like, he'll do something to where it makes him look good, but it won't make me look like shit. Like, he wouldn't do that. I'm a sparring partner. You know, he can do it, right? These guys are gonna be there. I don't think he will. I think they'll put some pictures out where we're sparring, maybe giving us both good looks. I think that's probably what he was going in assuming. Uh-huh. Of course, assuming is never a good thing. But I legitimately feel like this is an ego thing. But because he's having to defend his stance on what he feels really happened, I think it's now generating this buzz of all these conspiracy theories that I mean, I guess you can kind of see where it's coming from. So I think it's inadvertent, like, to be quite honest, without, again, reaching for a theory or without, I don't want to go too far on one side or the other. I try to be as balanced as I can. I obviously have a bias, but, like, I would rather say, though, understand the full world of boxing too, as well, and where his mindset would be coming from. And I legitimately feel it's a huge ego thing. Like, it's just all ego. He wants to defend his ego, but by him defending his ego, it also plays up into the fight.
Now he's like, you
can't have one into the other.
Yeah, of course. Now, he's also said, no, and I agree. I understand. Listen, it may very well – so if you're lining up scenarios, the most likely scenario is that he's bitter that this happened. He's bitter that he looks stupid, and he's bitter that he has no real way to prove that he wasn't knocked down, right? He keeps saying, well, post the whole video. But then on Twitter, he's acknowledged multiple times that there is no video other than potentially some security camera footage, right? So – which wouldn't be released because that doesn't even make any sense. So if it's not even a professional video showing what was happening. So,
right, it's the security camera. Like, I can get what he's saying, like, but – and again, it's just he's defending his stance.
No. I'm saying, like, he has said multiple times, well, release the video, but then he's also saying, well, nobody was allowed to take video – but there is, like, a security camera stuff in there. It's like, well, come on. Like, if you know that nobody was taking video, you keep telling people to release a video that you know doesn't exist. It makes you sound petty. You know, it makes him sound like he doesn't. Again, it's just, this is all lending itself to why I'm so distrustful of the situation. Why I'm just like, this feels like he's selling a fight. It feels like he's hyping this fight up, and it feels like he is, like, him and McGregor have this predetermined, hey, check it out, I'm going to go lose to Mayweather, but don't worry, because I'm going to stay in boxing, and I think my best play is to maybe fight a guy like you. You know, like it just, I'm so, like, I, and I don't even watch WWE. I do not like wrestling. I used to watch WWF when I was a kid.
Right, I did too.
And WCW and whatever else. But, like, I'm not even a fan of that stuff anymore. But, like, that's just what I feel about this whole thing. And I feel I'm so distrustful. And everything that's happening, I'm just questioning. Because there's so much money at stake here.
Why would this whole sideshow even
be happening if it wasn't intentional?
Well, here's the way I feel, like, about, like, again, looking at all the facts. I seriously don't think it has anything to do with money. I don't think Conor, maybe, again, this assumption would be, okay, Conor's paid him to say all these things and to make it look like, oh, man, we're having this big falling out. When in actuality, Conor's being really stingy with his money in this camp. The two main signs that point to that are, one, he's training at the UFC Performance Institute. Like, I get it. It's state of the art. It's great. And he should maybe do part of his camp there. But you want to do the majority of your camp at an old school boxing gym, man, like, to get the ambiance, to get the feel, or, you know, rent out a garage, like, do what all the boxing people that don't even make Conor money. They rent out a garage, or they rent out something. They rent out a space. They put a fucking ring in there. They put equipment in there. And it's old school, man. You get the old school feel. You can get all your work done in there, and then you go to another gym usually to get your strength and conditioning workout. And that's just that's the way it is. So Conor's actually working out at the Performance Institute for free. So one, he's got a free pass on that. He doesn't have to spend money on camp. Two, he didn't want to hire somebody like Stitch Duran to be his cutman because he said Stitch, quote, charged too much, is what Stitch Duran said.
Weird.
I don't fucking get it.
Why would you not want the best? Why would you not want the best?
Right. Like, even if you're not, even if you're not planning on getting cut, you're planning on getting punched. Why would you not want the best motherfucker there? Like, again, I think he's being super fucking stingy. So when I saw Pauly,
I mean, he went all out for the Nate Diaz camp.
Right. Like, I don't get why he wouldn't do this for this fight. Like, it's fucking, the pieces are there. And the thing that gets me is when Paulie said he didn't even pay me yet. Like, he hasn't paid me. And people are like, oh, I bet he's paying you. And he's like, no, he hasn't paid me anything. I'm like, I believe it. After the two instances of him not wanting to pay for a camp, like a proper – set up a proper camp. Of course, he's probably – his coaches will take a stipend at the end of the fight. But for him not to want to pay for a proper camp and then him not to want to pay for a service of somebody like Stitch Duran, strike three for me that tells me, okay, I'm being a cheapskate this whole thing, is when Paulie comes out and says – yeah, he didn't even pay me. I'm like, oh shit. Okay, so this is
it could further solidify that Conor McGregor is well aware that he's not going to win the fight. You know,
I don't think it is. Like you talk to him, you talk to like anybody that's around him, and you're like, Conor actually believes he's going to win the fight. That's Conor nuts. Was talking shit like he actually believes he's going to win the fight. I seriously. Again, I'm going for Floyd, but I seriously think Conor's walking in there thinking he's going to win the fight. Like, I think he's not doing this thinking it's for a payday. He's going to lose. No, I seriously think he is going to win this fight, which is great. I don't want to spend too much time on this particular instance, but that's my take on this. Like, if you look at everything, the world perspective, the whole perspectives and start to connect dots. Like, if you're going to connect dots and make a conspiracy, great. But give yourself the full perspective on everything. And again, I follow Conor's, you know, his team, and I follow Floyd's team on all social media. I watch their interviews that they do to people like the coaches or just other people. And Stitch Duran, when Stitch Duran came out and did that interview, I think it was like in the last week or so, I was like, damn, dude, he didn't hire Stitch because Stitch is, quote, too much. Like, that's man, weird. He can't be. Yeah, that's.
But that's good information.
That was a red flag. I was like.
I did not know that. That is very good information, man.
Again, if you're going to make a conspiracy, give yourself the full benefit of looking at all the facts. Don't give yourself the microscope. Give yourself the macroscope. Look at everything that's going on in the world. And then look to see if you want to connect those other dots that you had or if there's a new way to connect the dots to make yourself and give yourself a better idea of what's really going on in the fight. And for me, I legitimately think that they didn't – again, outside of what I know on the back end of things, I legitimately think that they just didn't get along in camp, and Paulie's ego felt slighted. So he was like, "Listen, I can't do that. I can't put myself through this, man." That's seriously the way I feel about that.
So of the stuff you've obviously alluded to, you know, you have friends who are in the thick of a lot of this stuff. Talk to me. I mean, what can you, you know? What can you tell me? Obviously, don't say anything that you can't say, or don't say anything that's not necessarily public knowledge or stepping on anybody's toes. But you know, give me a little something. Give the listeners a little something, a little narrative to research. Tell us what we need to Google.
Google Paul. I mean, just look at all of Paulie's recent tweets, the ones in the last 48 hours, because everything, a lot of the stuff that's coming out there, is shit that. It's from his words and it's from his mouth, so it's a little bit more harsher. But let me just
pull them up. I'll just pull them up right now. Shit.
Yeah.
Let's just pull them up.
Yeah, do it. But a lot of the stuff he alludes to, in a lot of those tweets, I'm just kind of talking general and then I'll get specific. But there's a lot of things he talks about in there. The first thing, he wasn't allowed to bring anybody in his camp. That's very strange because when you go to a camp, you're usually allowed to bring somebody from your team, somebody to corner you. That way they can help give you pointers as you're sparring with somebody, right? Yeah. Paulie wasn't allowed to bring anybody into camp. Like zip, zero, nada. People that knew him in the scene, whether it was a cut man, whether it was a coach, somebody, they were not allowed to come into the UFC Performance Institute with them, which is very fucking strange. And is it because they just want to keep it secretive, or is it because they don't want these other people that Conor's sparring to have advantages? I don't know. But nobody was allowed to come in there with Paulie. Paulie had nothing going on. And, of course, there was always the camera guy. I think if you look on Instagram, his name is Gingerbeard Photos or something like that.
Yep.
He's Conor's camera guy. And he's like, yeah, he was snapping away, you know, as the sparring sessions are going. That's not normal. Like that's not normal. The instances where I think the biggest moment, And we'd probably get to this, the all access. That's really, you know, that's another thing I want to touch on.
Yeah, we'll get to that after we go. We'll go through all Polly's tweets, and then we'll get to all access.
Okay. So, but that was one of, like, that was actual, that conversation right there was like 50% of the conversation that, like, him and Connor had. Like, it wasn't anything longer than just a few moments. Like, people think, like, that they talked and chopped it up. Like, that was really, like, almost half of it. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, it wasn't much. Like, they didn't have much interaction. It was almost like, we've got respect, but we're not really.
Oh.
We're not really talking with one another like that. Can you hear me?
I can, yeah.
Okay, but yeah, but we're not really talking like that. We're not really, you know, doing this whole being buddy-buddy type thing. We just got respect for each other, and I'm here to do a certain job. And then
Melissa's making another guest appearance on the LoudMouth MMA podcast.
I know. They said hi. But yeah, what was I saying? But yeah, it's really like he's spelling it out the way that I heard it.
Yeah.
He's spelling things out on Twitter the way that I heard it, but even more. Like I say I got bullet points. He's direct diving on some of those bullet points. And let's pull up just a few of those tweets.
I got it. I'm gonna go through everything here. So if you have to take care of something real quick, you can. I'm gonna read his entire statement real quick, so everybody can hear it. Put everything into context. Here was his statement: I just wanted to clear the air. I'm leaving the McGregor training camp today. I came with the best of intentions and intended to help out. Just the chance to be a part of such a big event in this capacity excited me. I believe Conor and I have mutual respect inside the ring, earned from each other with some good work over two sparring sessions. It's some of the stuff outside the ring and some ways some things were handled in training camp that I didn't agree with that made me come to this decision. It's not my place to dictate terms in a training camp that is not mine, but it's my place to decide if I want to be a part of it. I will not give away anything tactical that I saw in two sparring sessions with Conor. For what it's worth, they have my word. The things that upset me, though, I will speak about in time. I wish Team McGregor well in the rest of their preparations and look forward to being back in Vegas to work Fight Week on Showtime. So that was his official statement. Let's scroll down here in his Twitter feed. I'm just going to go through today. I mean, obviously, there's been a lot that popped off before today, but you're talking about having to go pretty far back. There's a lot of stuff. Let's just kind of go to his most recent stuff. So his last tweet was 8 hours ago, basically, again, asking for the video of the knockdown. The tweet before that was the one I alluded to, where he is posting the GIF of McGregor being submitted by Diaz and basically saying that he quit. Hashtag no balls is what he said. Which, again, I take issue with that personally. Being an MMA fan, being a UFC fan, you know, I think other MMA fans, to include you, Blake, I think you should find it.
Yeah.
I think you should have a problem with that. I mean, if you're a boxing fan and an MMA fan, I think this is an instance where, as a boxing fan, you should side with the MMA people here. Because, again, what Conor has done and can do inside the octagon, Paulie would not be able to withstand. He would not be able to handle it. He would lose very quickly and soundly, and it would be an inhumane event for him to go against even a low-level, you know, jiu-jitsu practitioner. Inside.
Well, it's neither place for a boxer to talk about an MMA fight.
That's what I'm saying. So I agree.
To talk about a boxer, you know what I'm saying?
And I agree.
Neither place for either one. It goes both. Like I feel like what you're saying, but it goes both ways. Like neither one should be happening, you know?
But I'll say that he is not an MMA fan, right? So MMA fans who are MMA fans who will post things about Conor or about Mayweather running away in a fight or something, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's stupid and asinine, right?
Right.
But that is some dumbass UFC fan. Paulie is a championship boxer and, you know, combative sports athlete, however you want to put it, right? Uh-huh. He knows better. You know, UFC fans don't know any better. They're morons. He knows better. So that's my point, is that I take issue with high-level people coming out and saying stuff like that. He knows better. He realizes that if he were in the same situation, the fight wouldn't have gone longer than 30 seconds. So I'm just saying, stay in your lane. given the professional nature of your position. I also want to tell MMA fans to stay in their lanes, but they're fans. It's just most of these people have never even left their state, let alone, you know what I mean, done anything.
Yeah.
So they get a pass just because of that. Okay.
So so one thing I can say is the hotel room. Somebody said it's not void. I guess we're talking about the NDA. It's not void. You left out, and I'm sure he paid for a hotel room, so you got paid one way or another.
For those who don't know, NDA means a non-disclosure agreement.
Yes, it's exactly. And you usually sign those when you spar. That way you don't give away nobody trade secrets. And then he writes back, hotel room? ! Buddy, you're too much of a groupie, and you give your guy way too much credit. Hashtag, LOL, hashtag tight pockets. Yeah, Paulie didn't stay with, in his own hotel room. He stayed with sparring partners that were out there. He stayed with maybe some – but maybe some other people that he knew out there. He never had, his own, quote-unquote MySpace. You know what I'm saying? He was out and about, never once got comp for room or nothing like that, which – I mean, they flew him out. I mean, I don't know. I've never had a sparring camp, never had a fight camp, but you may want to take care of your guys if you're gonna, but whatever deal you worked out and you came in knowing, okay, that's, that was your thing, but it's a true statement. That's absolutely a true statement. That was something that I heard too. So, let me see.
Why did somebody say, this is my point right here. This is some MMA fan. He said he doesn't – he was talking to Paulie. He said he doesn't have an agent, referring to Conor, and doesn't have a manager, again, referring to Conor. He has a contract with the UFC. Okay, can I – let me just speak real quick. Give me 2 seconds. Dear UFC fans, and I know I just talked about this. I just talked about this. And listen, it's not your fault. It's not your fault.
You don't know.
You don't know any better. You don't know any better. You don't. You don't study the sport. You were brought into the sport because of Conor McGregor, and because of that, you have. And listen, he is a huge reason why I'm such a big MMA fan, right? He's a massive reason, and he is for a lot of people. Even people who came to the sport before Conor have remained with the sport because of him, or have grown a more familiar attraction to it because of him. He's very, very important to the UFC and to MMA and to us fans. He 100% is.
Absolutely.
But listen, you don't know what you're talking about with a lot of this stuff. First of all, of course he has an agent. Second of all, of course he has a manager. Come on.
Oh, man.
Guys, first of all, he's signed with
Paradigm.
Yeah, first of all, that's
and
public knowledge.
And the guy that owns Paradigm, Adi Attar, is his fucking publicist. That's his agent.
Listen, you guys don't know what you're talking – because the problem is that it – now, why is Paulie even responding to shit like that? That's just a dumb – why would you even respond to that? You know what I mean? It's
thing. I don't know why Paulie's, responding to
And he also – because what he said there, he says, you just lied through your teeth. Conor does have an agent. I don't know if the guy was lying. I think he just didn't know. I think he just doesn't realize. He's not lying, at least as far as I'm aware. I don't know who the person is, but –
But again, that's a hot tempered answer. An answer that you're just like, oh, for real? Click, 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 click. It's not like a click, click, click. Let me think about. Okay, click, click, click. No, again, it's ego. I think he's just feeling on the defensive, bruised ego. Again, I bring up he's Italian because he's fucking Italian. They got hot blood. That's just facts. You know what I'm saying? Sopranos was an Italian dude for a reason. It works because he's Italian. It's hot blood. These guys are just boom, boom, boom. And I think he's very much on the defensive. Again, whether it's him being attacked by the multitude of Conor fans, multitude of MMA fans, multitude of people that don't really know the situation, a multitude of people, just attacks, 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 attacks. Him being a boxer, him leaving camp, by motherfuckers who just don't know. That's really what it is. And I think he has to feel he has to take a defensive stance, and that's the way he feels. Great, but I think it's inadvertently – is inadvertently adding hype to all of this, so whether he's doing that on purpose or not, I don't think he's concerned with that. I think he's just concerned with defending himself and telling people that they're stupid, which is they make for some hilarious tweets, let's be honest. But I think that that's his primary objective. Again, you know, above everything right now, like it's just taking a defensive stance and trying to, for him to clear his name, since there's nobody else out there really trying to clear his name.
Yeah,
you know, this, like that's really it.
One of the Twitter comments on one of the Pauly's posts said, "Pauly is just another Chris Van Hurt Heerden trying to make a name off Conor." Let's be real. No one knows who the fuck Pauly
Malignaggi is.
Was before LMAO.
Oh my god.
I'm not even a boxing fan and I knew he was. Oh Jesus.
I think for casuals they didn't know, but I think that's so that's
a struggle.
True for casuals, but yeah. it's you're toeing the line right there of like ignorance.
I just,
which is hilarious.
The problem is it's so unhelpful. You know, it's like there are some real reasons why this fight is more interesting than just Mayweather is going to go in there and walk all over Conor. You know, there's legitimate X factors. There's, you know,
it's all these side stories.
There's real storylines here. Like, and it's all being distracted.
Yes, it's all minor storylines that are connecting to the end goal. And we're like, damn, like, yeah, that connects to this. And then this other thing, like last time we talked about was Instagram where Conor was wearing not the CJ Watson jersey, but the number 23 jersey, yeah. You know, because we don't know if it's really Watson, but it's just like, damn, that's a thread line. And like every time, like the press conferences, that's a thread line. Like all these thread lines, they're roundabout ways of all getting to the same place that we're talking about. So it's attracting every time there's a new thread line, it's cutting through a multitude of people that are snagging onto that thread line and getting to the goal line the same way people who don't even need that are. Like, we're all going to the same place, but new things are grabbing new people. Like, I had one of our friends come by Friday night. They're like, oh my god, what happened with this boxer guy who left Conor's camp? And I'm like, you don't even watch MMA. What the fuck are you talking about? Like, so like
I've had so many people I went on vacation the other day. I don't want to say anybody's names, but well, even when somebody I had my wife's friends came into town. They're friends of mine too, but mm-hmm. they were friends with her, and when I married her, they were friends that, you know, I then met.
So you married into friends?
I married into friends. You know what I mean? It's they are my friends too, but it's, yeah, it's
they're
not,
her friends.
It's not,
really,
it's not people
yeah.
It's not people I grew up with or anything.
Right.
But anyway, never talked to him ever about MMA or UFC or anything. Doesn't watch it, as far as I'm aware. First thing he says to me when he gets here. So, you know, what do you think about this Mayweather McGregor thing? I mean, it has permeated into the culture, and it has touched people. You know, my wife's cousin, who as far as I'm aware doesn't watch all of the stuff, watched UFC 214 with me because of the McGregor Mayweather stuff. You know, I mean, it's just it. This is so much bigger than I think even you and I who talk about this stuff all the time. I
can comprehend. Yeah.
I do five MMA shows a week and I can't even wrap my mind around what's actually happening right now. You know, it's incredible.
I do ones dedicated. I've been doing the Money Blakeweather Chronicles dedicated to this. And
we've obviously had a bunch of episodes too.
And we've had the ones here too. And it's just like there's still so much more. Or the storyline still can go on forever and ever because this is such an interesting thing to talk about, man.
Agreed, man. This is incredible, and it's a lot of fun. But okay, so before we get into, because I want to get into All Access, I, of course, because I'm an asshole, did not watch the second one.
Okay.
But that's fine. I'm going to let you spoil everything. I just want you to tell me what you learned. There's been two released, correct?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I just kind of want you to tell me what you learned from those two. But I want to do two things real quick.
Mm-hmm.
First, let me give a shout out to my sponsors before we keep going.
Yeah.
One of them is the Voball. And I appreciate you helping me out the other day. So I want you to kind of describe. I want you to help me out even more.
Okay.
So you've seen the Voball. You don't have one yet, correct?
No, I don't have one.
Okay, we're gonna change that. I'm gonna talk to Chris. We're gonna get you a Voball. That's not even a question. It'll be at your house in a couple of days.
Okay, dope.
So describe it to the best of your abilities, given that you have a boxing background.
Okay, the Voball is basically, for anybody who's boxed or gone to a gym, it's a double end bag. And for people who are like, what the fuck is a double end bag? It's the bag that you see boxers, or you saw Floyd Mayweather at the beginning of this camp hit. One half of it's tied to usually an upper half. It's tied usually to a roof or a high place chain, and then you have the other part that's attached to the ground, and you have a ball, a small ball in between, and you hit it, and it bounces to you back and forth, and it's attached to two ropes. The vault ball is basically just half of that. It's just the top half of the rope attached to a ball, and you hit it, and it just goes by you. It bounces off the, you know, whatever. It's attached to the ceiling or whatever, but it's basically half of a double end bag, which is really helpful, especially for movement and, you know, hand, you know, just accuracy, a lot of the little nuances. But that's it's basically half of a double end bag for anybody who was looking into it.
And then the ball is much smaller than what is on a double end bag. The Vo ball is going to be much smaller.
You can actually get the double end bags that have about a tennis ball size.
Oh, really?
Similar to a Vo ball.
Well, and it also comes with two. It comes with the Vo ball comes with the bigger one, which is about the size of like a cantaloupe in my mind.
Okay.
And it's supposed to be for like kickboxing. You know, that way you have.
Oh, nice.
Or if you just need a bigger target, right? Because the actual Vo ball itself is smaller than a tennis ball. So it's really about precision. You know, he wanted it to be pretty small. But the big thing is it bounces off the ceiling and it comes back. So, and it's to train head movement and that kind of thing. So I wanted you to help better explain that. That way I can continue to help tell our listeners and explain them what it really is. But as I always say, even with us explaining, you should definitely go watch the videos. There are tons of videos of people using them. They're fantastic. Go to their Facebook, Voball, V-O-B-A-L-L on Facebook. I believe it's one word. And then go to the website, thevoball.com, and check out their product. Also, the Glen Avenue Soap Company, that's glenavsoap.com. You never know. Listen, this is what I tell people. Go to the website, and that's all I'm asking you to do. I'm not saying you got to buy anything. Just go check it out. The thing with organic soap is that you're not necessarily sitting around thinking, man, I really need to go out and get some organic soap, right? That's not usually what's happening. What happens is you see something when you're out at a store and you go, oh, that seems like a really cool product. I'm going to get that. So that's what I want to create that experience for you. So go check it out. And I guarantee you, once you go on the website, you're going to see something and you're going to go, oh, that's awesome. Like, they're bath bombs, right? They're organic bath bombs. Like, oh, that's awesome. They're beer soap. That's really cool. You know, they're whatever. You're going to see some stuff you like. They're lotion. It's all organic. It's a fantastic company. Okay, the other thing I'm going to do with you, Blake, before we get into the all-access stuff.
Okay.
I want you to tell me, and this was inspired by Keith, okay? So you got to give Keith credit for this.
Okay.
I want you to tell me three deficiencies in Floyd Mayweather's game. If you can't give me three, that's fine. You got to at least give me one. Everybody has a deficiency. What is Mayweather's deficiency?
Well, the main one is obviously the right hand, and it doesn't matter if you're orthodox or southpaw. And I did a video on this, showing the like four times that he's been hit. And three of the times was with the right hook, and one time it was with the overhand right that rocked him, where you visibly see him rocked. So the right hand, no matter if you're – two of the guys that hurt him were orthodox and two of them were southpaw. So it doesn't matter the stance because that's the equal, right? You know, you got 50-50. Doesn't matter. But the right hand more – you know, and if you want to even get more specific, the right hook, that is I would say kryptonite. Because one out of every 613 right hands is the one that hurts him. But if any punch is going to be the one that gets him, it's a right hook. That's a deficiency. I would say it's a major deficiency. Two would be just kind of doing – MMA fans will be accustomed to this – doing the Jose Aldo, taking sort of the middle rounds off even when you're ahead. Sometimes he'll do that.
Sure.
I don't know if it's because he's bored. I don't know. It's because he stops, you know, he feels like he downloaded some stuff, but then you're giving him some new looks. So now he's having to re-download some new information on you. I don't know what the reason is, but sometimes he'll take, you know, some of the end of the middle rounds off, like 7, 8, 9. He'll take those rounds off and then come back strong at the very end.
Okay.
And then number three, I don't know, man. I have a bias for him, but I want to make a number three just so that way you know, I make it fair.
Challenge your bias. Well, because
right.
So as you're thinking of a third one, let me as a you know, you're an MMA fan too, but you're obviously taking the boxing approach. So let me take the MMA approach here. What are Conor McGregor's biggest deficiencies going into this fight? Number one, he's not a boxer. Number two, he's not a boxer. And number three, he's never boxed. So there you go.
Well,
that's Conor McGregor's deficiency going into fighting Mayweather. No, obviously he's trained boxing his whole life, and he was an amateur boxer growing up. His striking has been what has gotten him to where he is. Obviously in MMA, but he's not a boxer. I mean, you train your whole life to do this one thing. Listen, it's like playing darts or archery. It's mm-hmm. such a specific skill that even if you have incredible hand-eye coordination, it doesn't mean you can go in and beat the world darts champion.
Right.
Even if you have the greatest hand-eye coordination ever, which is essentially all you need for darts. But the thing is, the people who are world champions at darts have trained so specifically for that thing. They know the weight of that thing. They know the wind in the room. They know everything. That's how they're able to be so efficient in that sport. That is what you're going to see here. That's what you're seeing right now. I love Conor McGregor. I hope I would give untold amounts of money if it would solidify the fact that Conor McGregor could win. Because I want to see it more than life itself. It's not going to happen. And the reason why it's not going to happen is because he's not a boxer. And he's stepping into a world that it is so specific. There's no way for him to learn everything that he needs to learn to win in a fight like this. Although I would say, as soon as the fight was booked, he won. Because holy shit, he's going to make a ridiculous amount of money doing this. He could theoretically just ride off into the sunset at this point.
Right.
So good for him.
And then a third deficiency from Floyd would be,
please,
people who are swarmers. Like I told you on the first one, those are typically the people that give him problems when you throw a combination of 6, 7, 8 punches. And even if they don't land, you do it again, you know, you'll get two that land. And even if you don't do it the next time, one will land. Those are the people that give him the most problems.
Do you think Conor is going to come into this fight and basically balls to the walls for two rounds?
No.
You think it's going to be more calculated?
He's going to try and take a more, I don't say calculated either approach, but more of a counterpuncher approach. Like, he's going to try to counterpunch Floyd Mayweather.
It's going
to
be a counter versus counter, and we're just basically just going to see two people.
You think that's what you're going to see, but I think what you're going to see is if Conor wants to play the counter game, Floyd's okay with that. Like,
sure.
If you want to lay back in the cut, that's be okay with that, because Floyd will lead off. He'll lead the dance in round one or two. Like, people are like, well, we're going to kind of see stalemate. I think we kind of will, but Floyd's not afraid to press the action to get your reaction, even if it's not a counterpunch, just to see your movement. He's not afraid to do little things, even if he's missing, even if he doesn't have any intentions of landing. It's a repositioning. He just wants you to just move slightly when he attacks you so he can see where you're going to move and then throw your attack from that.
Yeah.
So that's what I'm expecting. I'm expecting Conor to – if Conor wants to come in with, again, this unorthodox game that we've never seen, and you look at different martial arts, maybe something like kickboxing or, you know, point karate, you know, where you're laying back and looking for the right place to hit. It's going to be a long night for you. It's going to be a long – I think one of the rounds, though, he will come on strong. I don't know if it'll be the first or the second. I think it might be the third and the fourth. I think he's going to switch his game plan up. Do this, do this, do this, do this. Just to give Floyd a different look. But he doesn't know – like, you can't make pretend that you're something that you're not. You can't make pretend you're a swarmer when you're not, right?
Sure.
You can't make pretend to throw all these different punches in all these different ways if you're not that guy. You can't pretend to be a bully if you're not that, because you haven't had long enough to develop that skill.
Blake, I was going to say, you know what? We're kind of running out of time because I like to keep these short so that people mm-hmm. can really ingest them. But I think it's actually kind of perfect because 3 is a good number.
Okay.
Let's get together after the third All Access and let's do a recap show of those three, and let's have the next episode be exclusively talking about those three episodes. So okay. I will bone up. I will watch all three. Obviously, you'll watch all three probably more than once, and I will try to watch all three more than once because they're not necessarily that long. So let's do kind of a full recap of those three and see what we learned and you know, see if there's anything that tickles your fancy or tickles my fancy.
That sounds good.
Does that sound good, man?
That sounds good. I didn't want this to be a lot of the Polly Connor thing, but it is what it is.
I didn't necessarily either, but I just, and it wasn't my plan. I didn't have a plan, but I it is interesting and it is a storyline and it is important to talk about. And it gave me a chance to at least get out there the fact that I think it could all be fake, Blake. I think we could all be tricked. I got my tinfoil hat on. But Blake, you know what time it is, buddy.
Yeah, man, it's shout out time, man. Everybody, oh, it's Selena time. Oh my God, it's Selena time. I love it. Yeah, everybody, go follow Loaded Joe's MMA podcast, Twitter, Stitcher, Facebook, iTunes. Yeah, I try to do as much content as I can. Please go follow LoudMouth Boxing. We're doing some awesome stuff there again with the LoudMouth Network. And then yeah, go follow me, Money Blake Weather. Type that in Facebook, Twitter. You know, send me a message. You like it, you don't like it, whatever. And thank you for everybody who listens. And, you know, shout outs, gives a compliment, gives respect. You know, I definitely thank y'all.
Blake, you make my heart go bitty bitty bum bum, my friend.
I love it, man.
I was like, for those who don't know, that is actually what this song is about. all right. You can find me at Loudmouth MMA. On Facebook, on Twitter, on Instagram. I need to start using Instagram more. I'm a piece of shit. I don't keep up with my social media.
Oh, yeah, you are. Don't follow
me
on Instagram, though.
I'm the worst person. I'm the worst. just lazy. And, of course, you can find the podcast wherever you're listening to a podcast. And, again, wherever you're listening to it right now is perfectly fine with me. Just remember to subscribe, and leave a 5-star review. Those 5-star reviews help out more than you would ever know. So please go check them out. Blake, do not hang up because it will disrupt the feed on the episode. Goodbye, my friend. We will talk again soon.
All right. Peace.